Good morning and welcome. I'm glad that you're joining us for worship this morning. I want to ask everyone, if you would, to fill out a Connect card. You can find that on the church app or maybe on our website. Just fill that Connect card out to let us know that you are joining us this morning. That'll help us to know who's all participating. But if you have a prayer request or you have a question you want to ask, a comment you want to make, you can also do that on the card as well. And so we want to hear from you if you've got something you want to share with us. Today's a little different. For one, it's Valentine's Day, and Valentine's Day doesn't typically happen on a Sunday, not when we're worshiping together. But today is Valentine's Day. So if you have not gotten a gift for your husband or wife or the love of your life, it's probably too late. So we'll pray for you later on. For me, it's different because my wife has left me for a younger, cuter guy who's less hair than me, who's only 2 weeks old. She's gone to help take care of our grandson, Jace. And so she'll be there all week. Because it should be snowing when we're seeing this, and we should get a lot of snow this weekend, and then later in the week we should get a lot more, and so she might be there all week long. You know, speaking of the snow, that's the reason that things are so different today for us, that this worship service is actually pre-recorded. Yesterday afternoon we had to make a decision about whether we were going to meet at the building or not. And because of the weather reports that we were getting, that we should have some significant snow by then and the roads might be dangerous, a decision was made by the eldership to go ahead and cancel our live service there and do a pre-recorded service, which meant that we had to put together things pretty quickly. Actually, Mitch is the one that's doing most of the work with this. But so all of this is pre-recorded. In fact, I'm kind of, I guess, since I recorded this yesterday, as I'm participating with all of you today, I'm actually talking to myself, which seems a little weird. Some of you guys may have talked to yourselves before, and I have too, but this is a different way of doing it. So I just kind of thought about that then. So I guess that really didn't have anything to do with any of this stuff. But so this is a pre-recorded service. And it was something that began that we were having to put together yesterday afternoon, and so quickly having to put together, I guess you could say. And so when we have our song service, one or two of the songs may be songs from our past worship times that have been recorded. But some of the songs will actually be from Tyler Wiggins and his praise team. He's the worship leader at the church he attends down in Georgetown. And because he's got something already set up to easily plug in to what we are doing. And so that's not typically how we do things. We don't usually use a praise team, but today there will be a praise team involved in that for some of the songs. And so I wanted to make you aware of that. That's another way that things will be a little bit different for us, but that's not typically what we do. Hopefully next week we'll be able to join together through live stream, some of us at the building and some at home. But today, let's worship. Let's worship the God who has created all that there is, the one who has created the snow, but who's also created the rain and the sunshine and the warm weather and the cold weather, the one who provides for us, the one who loves us, and the one who sacrificed his son for us. Let's worship him this morning.
There is beyond the ashes of the blue, a God concealed from human sight. He tinted the skies with heavenly hue, and framed the worlds with his great might. There is a God.
Oh, In heavenly armor we'll enter the land,
the battle belongs to the Lord.
Hey guys, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for today. Thank you for the technology that allows us to gather together in our homes and worship together at the same time. Thank you for this technology that keeps us warm in this crazy cold snap that we're experiencing right now. Help us to help our neighbors, to look after each other, to be there for anybody that we come across that is in need during this time, to be your people and help those that are in need when we can and where we can. Father, help us to get through this cold snap. Help us to meet again together soon this next Sunday. And Father God, just help us to be the church in these dire and crazy times that you have placed us here to be. We thank you for Jesus, his teachings, his example, and his sacrifice. And it's through him that we pray. Amen. Love you guys.
Good morning, Western Heights family. I know it's a strange day of worship, but I hope you're staying warm in your home. Have you ever wanted to be able to read someone's mind? I mean, maybe just at minimum know what they're thinking, without a doubt. You know, for a long time I wanted that ability. I wanted to be able to just know what someone was thinking. But the more that I began to hear what my wife was thinking, the more I realized ignorance might be bliss. Not because anything that she was thinking was bad or wrong or anything like that. It's just there were so many thoughts, my mind would explode. Today is Valentine's Day. I'm sure you know that, but I'm also sure that there is someone listening that needed to hear that. And they're thinking to themselves, oh snap, I forgot. If that's you, it might be too late. We'll send flowers to your funeral if that's the case. There are some people that want the simple things for Valentine's Day. It's the simple things that satisfy them. It's totally fine. They just want the card. They want maybe some flowers. Maybe just to grab some ice cream together. Keep it simple. But there are others that want everything. They want everything for Valentine's Day. They want the getaway. They want the dinner. They want the chocolates. They want the flowers. They want the teddy bear. They want it all. And truth be told, they may never be satisfied with what they get. Satisfaction. It's a feeling that comes whenever a need or a desire or even an expectation is fulfilled. Whenever something is gratified. It's truly a wonderful feeling whenever we are satisfied. It's kind of a time to celebrate when satisfaction happens. And to be honest, we are satisfied. We can feel satisfied when we accomplished all of our tasks for the day. When your to-do list is cleaned. You know, there's a sense of satisfaction there. Or maybe we can feel satisfied when we've aced the test that we've been studying for. Or maybe our satisfaction can come whenever our kids actually clean up their rooms. I know we're still waiting on that one, right? Maybe we feel satisfied when we've conquered the buffet at Golden Corral. Or on days like today, we may just be satisfied that we have a warm home. The problem, though, with that kind of satisfaction is quite often it's fleeting. It's chasing the wind. It's basing our satisfaction on temporal things. But there's another kind of satisfaction. A satisfaction that isn't so fleeting. It's the kind of satisfaction that comes from something that is complete. That something is fulfilled. In John 6:1-14, we have the story of Jesus feeding the 5,000. He does it with 5 loaves and 2 fish. As a result of this miracle, people follow him. They have seen this miraculous sign, they've seen this work, and now they want to see more, and they want to be fed with more of this miracle food. Jesus scolds them in John 6:26. He says, "You seek me not because you saw signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled." He then reminded them in verse 27, "Do not work for the food which perishes, but work for the food which endures to eternal life." Jesus then makes this startling statement in verse 35. He says, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall not hunger." Again in 48, "I am the bread of life." And one more time in verse 51, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven." All this talk about bread. You know, Jesus does a miracle with bread and then he talks about bread. I mean, what's the point? What's Jesus getting at? Well, in the ancient world, bread, as it is in some parts of the world even now, it's considered the essential food. Indeed, that we have actually understood bread to represent the wholeness of the meal. Sure, you may have meat, you may have vegetables, you may have other things, but this is my bread. This is my food. It's the mainstay of life. Bread is a primary metaphor for life, for sustenance. Jesus is really making 2 points here. As physical bread is essential for physical life, spiritual bread is essential for spiritual life. As you must eat physical bread to sustain physical life, you also must eat spiritual bread to sustain spiritual life. Jesus said in John 51, if we continue on, he says, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven." if anyone eats this bread, he shall live forever. That's enticing, right? And the bread also, which I gave for the life of the world, is my flesh. Now that's whenever it sounds strange. That's whenever we kind of take a step back saying, wait, hold up, Jesus, what are you talking about? The bread is your flesh? Verse 53 says, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in yourselves. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. Verse 56, he who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I in him. A lot of times we get into a rote understanding whenever it comes to the Lord's Supper. It's just something that we do every week and we gather for this purpose. And it's a wonderful purpose. But sometimes we just kind of walk through the motions and we forget how radically strange the idea that Jesus is saying is. Feast on my flesh. Drink my blood. These are not just strange statements, they are powerful statements. Each week, as we share the table of Jesus together, as we break bread together, it's not just simply a reminder. Like some of us might need reminded what day of the week it is or that it's Valentine's Day today. It's not just simply a reminder that, oh, it's Sunday. It's not even simply a reminder of what Jesus did for us on the cross, that he gave his life. It's more than just a reminder of Jesus' sacrifice. The bread is a reminder of the bread of life. And the bread sustains us. Now, not physically. We're not going to have a meal that will sustain us from this little pinch of bread. That's not going to be enough to satisfy our bodies, our physical bodies. This bread sustains us because it fills our soul. And every week, we come to his table to be reminded, to be filled, and to be satisfied with the spiritual food of the bread of life. So let's take a moment and share this bread together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the bread of life. We thank you that you gave your life for us, that you gave your life as a sacrifice, that you were willing to die for us. And you ask us to feast on your flesh. You ask us to remember you. Lord, in this moment, as we are separated, as we are separated physically from one another, may we be reminded of the spiritual binding that this bread represents. That as we partake of the body of Christ, we are and become the body of Christ. No matter where we may we be joined with you. Lord, bless this table, bless this bread. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Isaiah 55 starts off this way. Come all who are thirsty, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread, and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen to me, and eat what is good, and you will delight in the richest of fare. Much of our lives, we labor and we toil for the things that don't truly satisfy. We keep on chasing the wind, as Solomon would say. We keep on trying to be satisfied by the things that just can't satisfy. Sure, they can bring momentary pleasure in just that simple satisfaction that we can have, but it doesn't last. Isaiah here is saying, hey, come. He's beckoning us. Come, if you're thirsty, if you have this longing within you, come. Come drink. Come be filled with something that is truly delightful, something that is truly satisfying. The wine, the cup that we share at the Lord's table each week, it is no less significant than the bread. Spend some time talking about the bread of life and the recognition of that. Well, the cup is also symbolic. The wine means something. Jesus is pretty clear about what it means. Matthew 26, verse 27, and he took a cup of wine and he gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, each of you drink from it, for this is my blood. My blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many. This cup represents the blood, the sacrifice of Jesus. But I like how Jesus says it. He says, this cup confirms the covenant between God and his people. Let's head back to this idea of satisfying. Okay? One understanding of satisfying isn't just this feeling that I have. It is also comparable to the articles of an agreement. Let's say I'm going to take out a loan with a bank. And so whenever I do that, we come into an agreement. The bank has the money. I want the money. In order for me to get the money, I must sign a contract that says I will pay back said money at a certain interest rate for a certain amount of time. And when we've agreed upon that and everyone's happy, then I get the loan. Now, sometime later, as I have satisfied my end of the bargain each month through those payments, there will come a day, Lord willing, when that loan is paid off. One could say that that loan is complete. It is now satisfied. And that is truly a big idea. To satisfy a loan, it is to complete it, to be done. So the covenant, going back to the covenant, he says, this cup confirms the covenant between God and his people. The covenant is an agreement between God and his people. And it's summed up in Jeremiah 30, 22. He says, you will be my people and I will be your God. When we come to the Lord's table and we drink from his cup, we are satisfying our end of the covenant. We are proclaiming that Christ is Lord, that his sacrifice is enough. He sacrificed his life. We give our lives to him. And when we take this cup, we come together in this covenant relationship that is satisfied. And it reminds us, continues to remind us that we are filled, we are sustained, and we are complete because of Christ. Would you join me in another prayer? Heavenly Father, as we take this cup, as we share this wine among us, this fruit of the vine, may we understand the debt of our sin, the debt of our sin is satisfied through your sacrifice and our following of you. That in this covenant relationship that has been all throughout Scripture, this desire for you to be our God and us your people, May this cup serve as our reminder, and may it serve as a symbol and a proclamation that we are continuing to hold up our end of the covenant. Bless this cup, Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I heard it said once that three nails didn't hold Jesus on the cross. His love did. I like that. I think that that's cute, but it also has great meaning. John 15, 13 says, "Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command." Christ demonstrated his great love for us by giving up his life. This is the ultimate sacrifice. This is what he came to do. And we have celebrated it this morning. This love that he showed for us can satisfy our souls. That deep longing that we have inside of us for something more, Christ offers that. But we need to remember our end of the agreement. Our end of this, he says, "You are my friends if you do what I command." So what does the Lord command? Well, if you follow the pages of Scripture, you're going to find a lot of commands. A lot of things to do and a lot of things not to do. And sometimes it can be a little laborious walking through all those details, but that's why we gather every Sunday, is to walk through a lot of those details and to understand what is going on with the commands. But Jesus sums it up pretty easily and nicely for us. Matthew 22:37, he says, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. A second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. The entire law and all the demands of the prophets are based on these two commands. Love God, love others." On this Valentine's Day, may we do all that Christ has commanded. May we love with a love that truly satisfies. And not just that is satisfying to God, may our love be satisfying, fulfilling, complete for everyone that we run across. This is our job. This is what it looks like to be a Christian. So maybe we're stuck. Maybe we can't get out of our homes for a few days because of the weather, or maybe the weatherman's wrong. Regardless, let's find ways to love each other stronger and deeper, because this is the command of Christ. This truly satisfies. I love you guys, and if you need anything, do not hesitate to let us know. We're here.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such challenge?
Brothers and sisters, what a blessing to be with you this morning during our time of prayer and communion and worship. I hope that you have been blessed by our time together. Praise God, we have a new sister in Christ. I want to be sure that everybody knows about Maria Lopez. Last Sunday, chose to put on our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in baptism. Many of you know her. Over the past few months, a lot of us have been able to get to know her and work with her. And Maria, you and your kiddos are precious. We are glad to have you. Welcome to God's family. Welcome to our church family at Western Heights. We look forward to working with you and helping you to become the best disciple of Christ that you can be. Stay safe and stay warm this coming week. We've got some cold weather ahead. If you're in need, if you need anything, reach out and let somebody know. We love each other at Western Heights, and we take care of each other. And don't hesitate to ask us for help if you need anything at all. I encourage everybody to take some time this week and reach out to two or three people that you haven't seen or been able to talk to in a while. Give them a call and enjoy some fellowship in that way. I also encourage you to look for some time to spend some extra time in God's Word, spend some extra time in prayer. I encourage you to do that this coming week. I want to share a passage from Philippians chapter 4. I want to remind you that Paul wrote this letter to the church in Philippi while he was in prison. What a joy-filled book of the Bible it is, and I encourage you to spend some time in the book of Philippians soon. Philippians chapter 4, beginning in verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Don't be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Give that some thought this week. Take it all to God in prayer, as Paul tells us here. Let's close our time this morning together in a word of prayer. God, we thank you for loving us. We thank you for being our Father. We thank you for the joys that come with being your children. God, we lift up our sins and our shortcomings and the things that keep us from you, God. Help us to be better, Father. Help us to grow. Help us to put away the things that keep us from being close to you, Lord. Help us to help each other do that, Father. Help us to see the opportunities that you give us every day to serve and to make disciples for you. We love you, Father. We praise you. We need you, and we thank you, God, for being so good to us. And we thank you for giving us Jesus. It's in his name that we pray these things. Amen.